What color is Guantanamo? When you close your eyes and think of the U.S. military prison camp at Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, what color do you think of? I get to ask silly questions like this because I'm an art historian. And like most of you, probably before about a year ago, Ida would have said that Guantanamo is orange. The orange of the jumpsuits worn by prisoners, their faces covered as they arrived at Guantanamo. The orange that has illustrated almost every news story about Guantanamo for the last 16 years. The orange we wear when we protest Guantanamo. The orange we wear when we parody Guantanamo. So, orange is what I thought when I got a phone call from a lawyer who said she represented some men detained at Guantanamo and asked if I would be interested in displaying some of the art they had been making there. What do you mean they're making art at Guantanamo, I thought. Orange is what I thought, but blue is what I saw. Blue skies, blue seas, blue waves stretching out to the horizon. As word spread that I was planning this exhibit among detainees and their lawyers, I started to receive more and more art and saw hundreds of depictions of the sea in all of its moods. In some, storms thrashed apart the last planks of sinking ships. In others, boats were moored safely to docks or scudded across endless seas. In some, clouds bunched in blue midday skies, and in others, they burned red in mid-ocean sunsets. One detainee was even making elaborate models of sailing ships out of scraps of cardboard, old t-shirts, bottle caps, and other trash that he was given by the guards. Why all the water? I asked the lawyer, and she shrugged. Maybe the art instructor had been giving them pictures of the sea. As it turns out, detainees had been in official art-making classes that started in 2009, shortly after President Obama took office. At this time, the Joint Task Force Guantanamo website started to brag that the classes provided intellectual stimulation to the detainees and allowed them to express their creativity. They produced earnest exercises, shading apples and the contours of empty glasses, things you might expect to see in a suburban continuing ed class. Except that the detainees were working while shackled to the floor, and they were shading with charcoal because the authorities worried that pencils might be sharpened into weapons. Except that apples and empty glasses take on different meanings when they're drawn by men who have been on years-long hunger strikes, violently force-fed every day. Except that each work that was permitted to leave Guantanamo bore on its reverse a stamp reading approved by U.S. military forces, signifying that U.S. censors had scrutinized the work for any hidden messages or communications to Al-Qaeda hidden in the squiggles of a flower. Finally, a former detainee explained the blue to me. He told me that Guantanamo is located on the shores of Cuba and that the detainees' cells are located just yards away from the sea. They can hear it, they can smell it, but because there are tarps on all the fences blocking their views, they can never see it. Only once, when the guards took down the tarps as a hurricane approached, could they see the ocean. And when those tarps went back up just a few days later, the detainee artists started to paint the sea to recapture the feeling of this brief moment of visual freedom. They painted the blue they could no longer see and the freedom they did not have. I put on the exhibit in a small art gallery at John Jay College, where I am a professor. It featured works by 8 men. 4 of these had been, after making their art, cleared and released from Guantanamo. Like hundreds of others before them, they had spent 10 to 15 years there after essentially being arrested for mistake. The other 4 men remain at Guantanamo, and of these, only one has ever even had charges filed against him. During the exhibit, I stood in front of this art with many people, everyone from family members of victims of the September 11th attacks to veterans and former Guantanamo guards. Some were angry, some cried, some thanked me for displaying the art, but they were all confused, just as confused as I had been. They came to the exhibit thinking orange, and they saw blue, and they had to reconsider everything they had thought was true about these men. The Pentagon was not pleased with the exhibit. They announced a rule change. Now, no more art is permitted to leave Guantanamo. Even if a detainee is cleared and released, he won't be able to bring any of his art with him. It might even be burned. Why? The Pentagon wants us all to keep thinking that the color of Guantanamo is orange. Orange, the color of nameless, faceless suspects. Not blue, the color of mourning, of dreaming, of hope. Orange, the color of the dehumanization that has allowed us to torture detainees and detain them indefinitely without trial, justifying our actions by calling them monsters or animals. Not blue, the color of the art that has the power to shock us into realizing that they are human beings who might deserve basic human rights. Now, Guantanamo isn't all orange, and it isn't all blue either. The more than 700 men who have passed through there and the 41 that remain, they're not all terrorists and they're not all innocent men. But to paint them as just one color is to render ourselves willfully blind. To see them as one color is to fail to render the careful justice that is the only thing that can help us catch the actual terrorists and prevent future acts of terrorism. So it turns out, asking what color is Guantanamo is not such a silly question after all. And in fact, I encourage you to ask it all the time. What color is this? What color is that? Who has made me see it this color? And more importantly, if I work hard enough, which of its other colors can I show to the world?